This is Jana with Purl Together. So last time we talked about the importance of swatching back and forth and making that kind of cookie cutter example of your sweater. So that's great, but if you're making a cardigan like we're about to start, you have the back and forthing of the body, but then we have knitting in the round for the sleeves. Now, if you really want to knit back and forth for the sleeves, you could do that and then seam them up, but most of us try to avoid seaming. So we also need to have an accurate swatch for knitting in the round. Now, many people knit differently in the round. Their tension is not the same as knitting back and forth, because when you knit across, then you purl back. When you purl back, you know how you bring the yarn in front? You're adding just a tiny bit of extra yarn to that stitch, and that affects your tension. When you're knitting in the round, you don't have any purl stitches, obviously, so your tension might be slightly different. Now, you don't want to have to knit a half a sleeve and then realize your stitches per inch is off. Maybe your sleeve's a little too tight or it's a little too baggy, and then you might have to rip out. So the way to avoid that is to knit a speed swatch in the round, and I'm going to show you how to do that. All right, I've completed my swatch cast on that I showed you in a recent video, and then I just knitted the first row after the cast on. Now, normally when we get to this point, you would turn this and you would purl your way back and you would knit flat. So I need to take my needle, pull my needles through, and put the stitches back on the other side so I can continue knitting on the right side of my swatch. So what that's going to do, though, is our working yarn is coming from the wrong end. So we're going to take your needle around, or double points, or whatever you're doing your swatch on, and we're actually going to pull the working yarn across the back and make a super long float. But we're going to make sure that it is not puckering. It's going to be long enough and create enough slack that nothing's going to be tight. We don't want this to be like a cylinder. We want it to be able to lay flat when we're done, instead of, you know, being a circle, or we're not knitting a tube with a loose end. So we're just going to pull this across the back and make sure we have plenty of slack. One thing you can do is put it across the back of your hand, but you still need to be mindful that your stitches are spaced out enough. If this was super bunchy like this and I pulled this working yarn across the back, that's not really going to help me make an accurate swatch, is it? So we want to make sure that things are spaced out well. I'm not going to have my stitches all the way to the end of the needle just yet. I want to do that, but I want to make sure everything's nicely spaced out so I know how much of a float I need to leave. Do whatever works for you. It doesn't really matter how long this is, as long as it's not pulling or causing any tension issues. Then you're just going to go in and start knitting back across. This is that first stitch is really tight on mine for some reason. So I'm just going to go in and start knitting back across. Now, sometimes on this first one, because your working yarn is coming from the left side, it's hard to wrap something like that counterclockwise. So I just use my fingers to help me pin that down on the back. Now, again, make sure that you have lots of slack back here for doing this and that things are spaced out, and that whatever float you've got going on here is nice and loose. Okay, this is also another good reason to have an extra skein for swatching. Now, I'm fully aware that my edges, the two or three stitches on the edge, are gonna be super loose and wonky. I know that, but I don't care, because what's inside here, the 5 or 6 inches that I have inside those edges, edge margins, what's going to be across here in the middle will be accurate, because I'm still knitting in a comfortable way. I'm not knitting and then purling. I'm just knitting and knitting and knitting in the same way you would in the round. So, okay, I've knitted my speed swatch round and round as much as I would like to. I probably have, well, I don't know, 4 inches or so here, maybe a little more than that. And I've ended over here like before, and I'm going to take this last mega float around. I'm going to take this last big section, big float thingy around the back, and then, same as before with the other swatch bind off, I've cut the yarn, leaving plenty to account for my giant float here, but also to account for going back through all the stitches that are on the needle so that I can take it off. I'm just going to do that, and then I'll be able to lay it flat. I'll have the needle off, and I'll be able to lay it flat to measure my gauge. Now, I am going to go ahead and measure my gauge in a preliminary way, but I'm also going to properly soak and block this swatch as I did with the other one that I knitted flat to get an accurate representation of what it would be with this yarn and needle combination knitting in the round. All right, I have my speed swatch laid out flat here. I do need to block it still, but I just wanted to give you an idea of what I'm doing and why. If you haven't had the opportunity to watch the other video where I talk about measuring your swatch, I just wanted to repeat the reason that I'm doing what I'm doing here. So when you're measuring your swatch, you want to measure whole stitches on whole inches. And what I mean by that is our gauge calls for 18 stitches for 4 inches, which is equals 4.5 stitches per inch. But it's really difficult for us to measure quarter stitches and half stitches. So if I start here on this stitch here, and I use the number 1 as my starting point because I don't like to try to start on the edge over here. So I'm going to measure whole stitches on whole inches. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So 15 for 4. Actually 3 inches, sorry. 15, so that's 5 stitches per inch. So that's a little small. I might actually need to do another swatch and size up. But again, I'm going to wait and see after I block it. But you see what I'm saying? If I was measuring 4.5 stitches per inch, and I had 4.5 stitches here, and then I had 9 here, well, that is a whole stitch on a whole inch. That'd be 9. But then when I get to here, that'd be 13.5. And it's sometimes difficult to determine half stitches or quarter stitches. So the only point there is that even if you have to count all the way out to, you know, 5 inches and say you get 30 stitches for 5 inches and then have to do the math to get your stitches per inch, then that's fine. You'll just need to do that. So I hope that makes sense. Okay, I hope you found that helpful and you're taking accurate notes for your knitting journal or you're putting it into Knit Companion or Ravelry or wherever it is that you keep track of these things. I like to keep an actual physical binder. So what I'll do with these swatches that I have, both the flat swatch, I've put a little string tag on here to indicate what it all is about. And I'm going to do the same thing with my speed swatch in the round after I get it blocked. So what I'll do is put those in a sleeve protector with maybe a note card or just those string tags that are on there. That's fine too. And then I'm also a pattern printer kind of gal. I like to print a hard copy of my patterns. Now I also keep a knitting journal that I'll show you in a future video. And yes, I also do my Ravelry page. So I know, I guess I'm the queen of redundancy, but that's okay. Anyway, if you find these tips and videos helpful, consider a thumbs up and hit the subscribe button. And thanks for your support.